केरला.
केरला, ओके. आई एम फ्रॉम हिमाचल प्रदेश.
ओके ओके ओके. सो व्हाई
हाँ
डिड यू गो टू द आई डोंट नो वेदर इट्स द स्कूल इन हिमाचल ओ
सॉरी.
वेयर इज इट लोकेटेड सौम्या जी.
ओ, दिस इज एट उत्तराखंड. दैट इज डिफरेंट
उत्तराखंड.
स्टेट.
ओके
यस,
ओके
ऋषिकेश.
ओके 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 ओके.
नमस्ते.
ओम शांति. ओम शांति.
ओम शांति.
लेट्स बिगिन टुडे सेशन देन. ऑलरेडी गॉट लिटिल लेट टुडे, सो बैक इन नेक्स्ट स्ट्रेट. Just sit comfortably on your mat, and when you feel ready, you can gently close the eyes. And start observing your breath. And make sure that you are aligned in your posture. Your back is straight, neck and shoulders are relaxed, and your weight is equally balanced on both the hips. And come back to your breathing. Slowly begin to deepen the breath. Relax your mind. And prepare the mind for the chanting of Om. We'll be chanting Om one time, followed by the Shanti mantra. Inhale deeply for Om. Sarve bhavantu sukhinah. Sarve santu niramaya. Sarve bhadram pashyantu. Shanti, shanti, shanti. Just feel the vibrations of the mantra. join the palms together in front of the chest and wrap them together. Place them on the eyes. Very slowly while blinking and looking at the palms, open up your eyes, start coming back with a smile. And namaste to everyone. Let us begin our session for today. Okay, so today we are moving one step ahead in our journey of pranayama. So we have done normal breathing where we observed our breath going in the system and coming out of the system, right? And then we progressed onto the practice of abdominal breathing. And yesterday we covered thoracic breathing. So today we are going to cover clavicular breathing. Clavicular breathing. Okay, so this is this when we do this, you know, mastered before stepping into the practice of pranayama, right? So abdominal breathing we had done, thoracic breathing yesterday we covered, in which, you know, we were expanding the chest and then contracting the chest as we were taking the breath. And today we are going to cover the third portion. So like I told you, the lower lobe of the lungs is being oxygenated properly by the abdominal breathing. The middle lobe of the lungs is being properly oxygenated when we go for chest breathing. This is it. And the upper lobe of the lungs is going to be properly oxygenated when we go for clavicular breathing, right? So clavicular breathing is when you have taken in the entire breath, but there is still a little bit more scope for you to expand the upper ribs. So when you take that forceful breath in, like when you breathe, you till a certain point, you feel that this is it, you know, this is full. And then you, you know, make an effort to take in a little bit more breath, draw in a little bit more breath. And when you do so, you are actually doing clavicular breathing. So the collarbones that we have right over here below our neck, you know, you will feel a very slight, very little rise in the collarbones, right? So this type of breathing will require you to put in maximum effort. So abdominal breathing was the way in which, you know, we put in the least effort. Then chest breathing, the effort increases a little bit. And by the end, you know, when we do clavicular breathing, we need to actually, you know, exert some force when we are taking in the breath so that we can feel that fullness of the breath. So the main physical way of judging the clavicular breathing is when there is a little bit, you know, rise in the collarbones, and then you will also see very slight movement in the shoulders, right? And this only you will be able to feel. So you can either cross your hands and place them on your collarbones when you do this breathing, so that even it touches your shoulders a little bit. So place them in this manner, or you can go for placing them straight as well, directly on the collarbones. But this is much easier, and you will be able to, you know, if you do cross the hands and place them on the collarbones, your shoulders will remain relaxed, and it will be easier for you to, you know, hold this for a longer period of time, this position, right? So now clavicular breathing, once again, when we exert ourselves too much, so going for too much physical activity, when we are totally, you know, exerted. And, you know, people who have breathing disorders, they generally have clavicular breathing, right? So it's going to strain them a lot, and it's not going to provide proper oxygenation in the body, right? So when this breathing is done in day-to-day life, so we are doing practice for developing the strength and correcting our breathing. But when somebody has this kind of breath pattern in the day-to-day life, means they are going through some respiratory disorder. So people who have respiratory disorders, you can, now they go for clavicular breathing. So now when you have to work with those people, you can incorporate abdominal and chest breathing for them, so that these portions of the lungs are also activated and utilized, and eventually the muscles are strengthened of the other areas as well, because they are completely working with the upper area and the lower areas are not getting activation, or the muscles are not getting that kind of movement, which generally when you take a full breath, there is some movement in the muscles that takes place. So they do not get that. So completely, there is no activity, right? So in order to, encourage that activity and strengthen the other parts of the lungs, you can introduce abdominal and thoracic breathing to those people, right? It will be greatly helpful for them. So anybody who's going through asthma, bronchitis, all of these issues, these practices are highly effective, right? So clavicular breathing is generally not, you cannot directly jump into clavicular breathing. As I said, it requires a lot of strain, right? Generally, we first work with thoracic breathing, where you are expanding and contracting the chest. So once you pick up that rhythm, that is when, you will be able to breathe in slightly more in order to feel that expansion in the upper part of the chest and the movement of the collarbones and the shoulders, right? So it's going to be a very subtle movement. So when you close your eyes, you will be able to feel it much more deeply. So today, first we are going to, I will introduce one more concept for today, and then we are going to practice everything together today, right? So then we will go step by step into the practice, but we'll practice in one go only, okay? So this was the concept of your clavicular breathing, right? When we come to the combination of all three breathings that we have done so far, so abdominal, chest and clavicular breathing, when all three of them are combined in one breath, it is called a yogic deep breath, right? So yogic deep breathing is today's second topic. So when we combine the three-part breathing, so the three-part breathing, works on each lobe of the lungs, strengthening them, giving them proper oxygen, and activating them, right? So when you perfect these three breaths, then you go for yogic deep breathing. So in yogic deep breathing, in one breath itself, you are first expanding the abdomen. Then as a part of that same breath, you expand the chest, and then the chest is expanded so much that there is movement in the collarbone. So clavicular breathing also takes place along with it. So this breathing is, when you experience this breathing, do not take the notion that, my abdomen was able to expand this much in abdominal breathing, but in yogic deep breathing, it's not expanding as much. That is going to be the case because when you are working on each part, then you are giving entire focus to that part. So you are maximizing the potential of that particular, breath. But when you are doing yogic deep breathing, you are doing all three of them together. So you are dividing your breath in such a way that the abdomen expands, then the chest expands, and completely the ribs can expand till the upper portion, right? So when you do yogic deep breathing, you are not going to experience each and every part expand as much as it did when you did the sectional breathing, but you are combining that rhythm together, right? So if you place one hand on your abdomen and one hand on your chest, just where your collarbones are, so that you get a faint idea of the collarbones as well. So when you start breathing, so first, your tummy will begin to come up. Now you're making a conscious effort that first, the tummy begins to come out. Then slowly as you breathe in, the chest will start expanding. And when you complete this breath, then you should feel slight rise in the collarbones, right? And you go into the reverse process when you exhale. So first the collarbones will slightly move down, then the chest will go back in, and then the abdomen goes back in. It's very simple analogy, like you fill water into a bottle, right? So first the lower part of the bottle gets filled, and as you fill in the bottle, the water rises and reaches the neck, right? So in that same way, when you breathe in, the correct breathing pattern is first the lower part of the chest, lungs should get expanded. And as the breath fills in, the rest of the lung should get expanded. And when you drain out the water, first the upper portion of the bottle will get emptied and then the lower portion will get emptied. So similarly, when you exhale, the breath also works in that way. When you exhale out the breath, first the upper portion should go down, and then you are going to finally reach a state where you contract the abdomen. So it's very important for you during exhalation that you contract the abdomen completely and take the stomach as close to your spine as possible, because that will lead to proper expulsion of the toxins from the body. And again, it is going to create proper space for the next inhalation, right? So yogic deep breathing is the, is a great practice if you face a lot of anxiety, or if you get angry very quickly. Yogic deep breathing has a very calming effect on our body and the mind, and it actually slows down the breathing process. And it is science is proving it. Slowed breathing patterns are connected to a more relaxed mind, right? So the slower you breathe, the better it is for your own sake, right? So when you go for yogic deep breathing, you will see only, if you take out few moments, or, suppose you are having a very stressful day and, you take out a few moments just to breathe and you go for yogic deep breathing, you will see that you feel much better after those 5 or 10 breaths. Just 5 or 10 breathings have that, strength to change the state of your mind completely, from chaos to a little bit stillness, right? Yogic deep breathing, when initially practiced, leads to the, we engage the abdomen, the chest, and the clavicular breathing as well. But as we proceed in the practice, as we advance in the practice, and the clavicular region is strengthened, the muscles are strengthened, we eventually remove the clavicular breathing, and yogic deep breathing is modified into just the abdominal and thoracic breathing, right? But that is a later stage when you begin to gain control over your breath. Before that, you go for all the 3 breaths as a combination together, right? In this order, right? Great practice for you to better your posture, to reduce stress in your life, and just to observe this, simple pattern of breathing. It is an amazing practice. Everybody can do it. You can do it in a laying posture. So that is a plus in this practice. People who feel very lazy or they don't want to sit for a long period of time, they can just lie down and do yogic deep breathing. It will give you the same benefits, the same impact, right? So everybody can practice it. That's the best part. And these pre-practices can be done even during illness. So if you are going through some illness, you can at least start deepening your breath, which will help you to calm the state of your mind and even to your, right? So any doubts in clavicular breathing or yogic breathing, both of them?
This clavicular breathing and yogic breathing looks very similar. I can't really find much difference.
No, clavicular breathing is mostly connected with the upper lobes. So like abdomen moves in and out, thoracic breathing, chest moves in and out. And clavicular breathing, the main movement is seen in the collarbones, right? And sometimes the shoulders are also lifted a little bit up, right? So that is clavicular breathing. It's not, yogic deep breathing is all 3 breaths combined together. like now in just one breath, you are expanding all three regions as much as possible.
Okay.
Yeah. Did that distinction become clear, or should I demonstrate once to you so that you can like get a better idea?
Yeah, you can demonstrate, please.
All right. So I'm just going to generally show this to you. Now, I think now my abdomen. Just give me a second. All right. So clavicular breathing is mostly this. When I place my hands on my collarbones, you will not be able to see it, but little bit rise is there. So you can just feel the rise in the collarbones. Right? So if I just give me a moment. Now just observe. Right. So in clavicular breathing, my abdomen has gone in, right, to support the chest breathing, and to support the chest breathing so much so that the collarbones will rise and there is slight movement in my shoulders also. I felt it, but I'm not too sure if it is visible. Now let me show you yogic breathing. So one hand is on my abdomen, one is on my chest. I have exhaled completely right now, and then so I'm now contracting in my tummy when I exhale completely. So full from here till here, there is expansion. So tummy won't be able to expand too much because you have to expand the chest also. But full movement from down till up movement is going on, then from up and down. This is yogic breathing. Clavicular breathing was mostly just restricted to this area of the body. Right? Did that become a little bit more clear right now?
I tried the clavicular breathing. It looks like, when I exert more, like it becomes like a ujjayi breath. I don't know why. I felt like when I exert more, mm-hmm. It is feeling like a ujjayi breath.
Ujjayi breathing is totally different. Yeah, in that we create a sound over here. The breath has to be smooth, right? Okay. And there has to be no effort, right? So when you do this breathing, so right now, because in clavicular, you have to make that effort. So the sound is coming out. But originally, the sound should not. Because you have worked on each and every part before you do yogic deep breathing, right? So even in clavicular, if you're just doing clavicular, initially, maybe you might experience this thing where, your body, in order to inhale more, is creating that sound. But technically, that sound should not be there. Okay, so you have to work on this. You will have to work on this thing where the movement of the air is slow. There is no breaking. So sometimes what happens is, when we want to fill in the entire breath, what we do is we inhale. So when I have reached my maximum capacity, I will hold for a few seconds and then I will inhale a little bit more again. Right? So just to feel that, now my collarbones are rising. So this is not the correct technique. Thus, air should flow in very smoothly without any break, right? And same with exhalation. When you are exhaling, the air should go out very smoothly without any break. So no sound should be there when you are doing either clavicular or uvic deep breathing. That means that you are putting in effort and you still need to perfect the sectional breathing first. Yeah?
Okay, okay.
Were you able to get a little bit idea of what I'm talking about? Like, what is the state I'm talking about? What is the stage that you are finally aiming for? It has to be effortless.
Okay. Was it needs to be effortless for clavicular and also yogic deep breathing?
Yes. Eventually, when you practice it a lot, the clavicular breathing also starts to become effortless. So, and right now, you will feel a lot of effort that you're putting into clavicular breathing also. But with practice and time, this effort is going to go down, right? Because you will work more on more and more on this part. So it is bound to go down, but it won't get as easy as abdominal breathing, right? Even when the effort goes down, it won't become as easy as abdominal breathing because you are, the area that you are trying to oxygenate, that portion of the lungs is not used in general breathing. So you have to put in some effort.
Okay.
Right? This you will see, this thing you will experience when you practice more and more, right? Okay. So comparative effort I'm talking of when I say that there is going to be effort, but originally where you begin and the amount of effort right now you're putting in, because the lungs are not, you're never used this portion or the lungs are not properly expanded right now. So yogic deep breathing helps you to, see the full potential of your breath. What is the full potential of the breathing process and how little of it you are utilizing right now? So it's going to, one thing is there is a comparison between three parts and there is a shift in effort. And one thing is when you begin the practice, suppose you begin the asana practice right now and you cannot do forward bend. But as you put in more and more work, do more Surya Namaskar or do more forward bending, you will see you will be able to touch the ground eventually. So, with time, the effort has reduced. So that effort I'm talking of when I say that eventually clavicular breathing is also going to go down in effort. But it is its nature to be more straining than the abdominal and thoracic breathing.
Okay. In all these four breathing techniques, which one gives the more oxygen to your body?
Yes. Yes.
Which
yes.
one?
You are utilizing the full capacity of the lungs, no? So more oxygen, is added to the body.
Oh, in yogic deep breathing. Hello.
Yeah, can you repeat in which one?
Is that in yogic deep breathing when the more oxygen gets into the body?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it does. It does.
Okay. So, what is the benefits for clavicular breathing?
Clavicular breathing is mostly, like I said, eventually clavicular breathing is taken out of the yogic deep breathing. Right, but the benefit of clavicular breathing is that one thing you are able to experience the potential of the entire lungs when you breathe. Right, so right now we are just functioning at maybe 30%, 40%, 50% of our capacity. So, first benefit is that clavicular breathing is going to help you to experience the full capacity of the lungs, right. Another benefit, it's going to specifically work on the oxygenation of the upper lobes, right? Another thing is that it's going to strengthen these muscles and train these muscles. So right now, because of poor posture and poor habits, we are not able to utilize this portion. So it is important to utilize it as well, right? So this is going to help you to gain more control over your breathing and oxygenate this portion better. So all of the, you know, blood vessels that are passing through this region of the body, of the lungs, they are going to get proper oxygenation. The exchange of gases over here is going to take place properly. And when the exchange of gases will take place, and of course, you know, oxygen will flow better to those regions to which these, you know, blood vessels are connected. And again, same thing, carbon dioxide will be cleared out properly from the body.
Okay. In clavicular, you said, like, you know, the people who are suffering from asthma and bronchitis and lung related diseases, they will be doing this clavicular breathing. So they must be doing, because they couldn't do the abdominal and chest breathing, isn't it? So if we tell them to do the other way, so will they be able to do it? In clavicular breathing, like, you know, some people who are suffering from asthma, bronchitis, that kind of diseases, they might not, they are, like, you know, trying their best to get some oxygen. So if we tell them to do abdominal or chest breathing, will they be able to switch it to the other breathing, because they have some limitations, isn't it?
So it is, yes, it is good for them. And the more you make them practice, the better they will get at it. So it's going to help them in their in dealing with their condition.
So when they don't have the asthma attack, like in the normal form, they can try the abdominal and chest.
Yes, it is very good for them.
Okay.
Any other doubts before we begin?
No.
Oh. All right. Yeah. No doubts? Okay. Sorry? All right. Okay. So let's begin with the practice for today. So today we are going to do all the three breaths, right? Sectional breathing first, so abdominal, thoracic, few breaths for abdominal breathing, few breaths for thoracic breathing, then few, very little.
Samyaji, one more question, please. If somebody got like a lung condition where like it's destroying their lungs, because mm-hmm. they are, some of the cells might not be working, so they are exerting because to get, they may be doing this clavicular breathing mm-hmm. all the time. So mm-hmm. if they need to get some, get a little bit better, because their lung is like that. So what can we do to them?
Can you name a particular condition?
I don't know the name, where, like, you know, there are some conditions where, like, you know, your own antibodies attacking your lungs. Mm-hmm. And it is like the cells are dying because of that condition. Mm-hmm. Some part of lung will be affected. So they are still suffering with the oxygenating part.
The abdominal breathing is beneficial for all such people. Abdominal breathing is suitable for every condition. In thoracic breathing, there is still some effort that you put in. So it depends from situation to situation. I cannot directly comment on that, since somebody might be having a more severe condition than the other one. But abdominal breathing, that can be given to everyone. It is a very efficient and effective practice.
Okay, thank you.
So,
ma'am, I have a question. What about the COVID patient that are suffering from breathing these days? How can we help them to, you know, breathe more? As we know, they are lacking of oxygen. They are having trouble in breathing. So how can we help them to improve their lungs?
Yes, abdominal breathing, yogic deep breathing are great practices for COVID patients. And as COVID patients are, like, you know, practicing more and more of these things, it is actually improving their situation a lot. It is helping them, because post-COVID symptoms are much more dangerous than actually the COVID condition itself, you know. After that, whatever people, you know, the breathlessness and post-COVID symptoms that are showing up. So for them, you know, abdominal breathing and UV deep breathing, even thoracic breathing, where they can, you know, utilize the lungs more properly. All of these practices are very, very effective. Very effective.
All the three practices.
Sorry?
Ma'am, all the three practices will strengthen their lungs. Are you saying this?
But clavicular breathing, I would say that clavicular breathing gives to someone who is healthy already, because that gets like pretty straining. It will strain your system a lot right now. When you will practice, you will feel this thing, you know, it's straining you out. So what about the COVID patient? Yes. You know, it will strain them out a lot too. But abdominal, even thoracic, I don't believe that there is any issue. Again, see the severity, you know, how severe their COVID was, because some people, you know, carry chest pain also after COVID. So for them, you can just introduce only abdominal breathing also. That will help them a lot to, you know, gain more oxygen in the body. And yogic deep breathing is also a very good practice for COVID patients.
Okay.
All right. Okay. So let's experience ourselves, right, today. All three part breathings we are going to do, and then we will do yogic deep breathing, right? So let's just make the back neck straight and sit comfortably on your mat. Adopt any posture that you are comfortable with, or if you feel like it, you can lie down. Just start observing your breath. The breath as it is. Don't change your breathing for now. Keep the body stable and comfortable. And very slowly place the right hand on the abdomen. Exhale out completely. Contract the abdomen and then begin to inhale. Expand your abdomen as you inhale. And contract the abdomen as you exhale. It's going for a few breaths of abdominal breathing. Smooth flow of the breath. And the mind is completely absorbed with the movement of the abdomen. Just take three more breaths. And then you can relax the right hand. Just keep the back straight and observe your normal breathing. Let's prepare for thoracic breathing. So place the right hand again on your chest. As you exhale completely, let the chest fall down and go in. And as you inhale, expand the chest properly. Feel the chest rise. And once you have inhaled, go into the process of exhalation. Feel the chest contract. Deepening your practice with each and every passing breath. Complete 3 more breaths and then you can relax your hand. And then you can just observe the natural flow of the breath. See how this practice was different from abdominal breathing. We're going to go for a few rounds of clavicular breathing. So once again, back neck straight. And you can bring both your hands and place them on the collarbones. Cross the hands and place them on the collarbones. Slight touch on the shoulders as well. And exhale completely. As you begin to inhale, expand the chest as much as possible. And then fill in a little bit more air to feel that rise in the collarbone. As you begin to exhale, allow the collarbones to go down first and then the chest to go back in. Then inhale again and step into the next cycle. Just complete 3 more breaths and then suspend the practice. come back to your normal breathing. Just observe the breath as it is. And just observe how this breathing was different from the thoracic breathing. The amount of effort that you were putting in this time was much more. Again, keeping the back and neck straight, let's go for a few rounds of yogic deep breathing. Place the right hand on your abdomen, left hand on your chest. Exhale completely. And as you begin to inhale, feel the abdomen rise. And then feel the chest rise. And expand the chest completely so that the collarbones move a little bit outward. As you exhale, feel the collarbones drop, chest go in, and contract the abdomen completely to exhale out all the air from the body. Then begin to inhale again. Go into the same process. Utilizing the full capacity of your lungs as you practice yogic deep breathing. Seeing how long your breath can be. And try to make it as effortless as possible. With each consecutive breath, try to suspend any extra effort that you are putting in. Just three more breaths. And then you can suspend the practice. Slowly relax the hands, keeping the back and neck straight, and just observing how you feel after the practice of yogic deep breathing. Mind is relaxed, and the breathing is very calm. Let us end today's session with one Om and three Shantis. Inhale deeply for Om. Om. Join both the palms together in front of the chest and rub the palms together. Generate heat between both the palms. Place them on the eyes. Allow your eyes to absorb this heat. One more time, let's rub the palms together properly so that proper heat is generated. Keep them on the eyes. And whenever you feel ready, slowly while blinking and looking at the palm. Yeah, start coming back. Namaste to everyone. I will take all doubts tomorrow.
Thank you.
Since we are already up on time, right? Already 5 minutes up. So keep all of your doubts with you, right? You can just note them down and I will take them in tomorrow's pranayama class. Okay?
Thank you so much, Soumyaji. Thank you.
Thank you. And Om Shanti.
Shanti.
Bye-bye. Om Shanti.